time is now. On everything. Took my heart away from money. I ain't interested in fame. And I pray that never change. Ambition is priceless. It's something that's in your veins. And I put that on my name.
So, myself, Brandon, and Pete, we actually went out to Massachusetts. We went out there to learn from Dark Dynasty. They're very high-end executive protection line pit bull training. So what they do is they train these dogs, they're about 125 to 160, even close to 175 pound dogs, to do executive protection, which is a lot different from schutz in any of the PSA sports. It's really targeted on, you know, a tactical binding. So, biting weapon hands, an intruder, something like that. They're really trained on a personal street level. I'm more favored towards Cassius Clay. That's the dog that actually kind of got me looking at them. It's a blue dog. It's not a giant. He's like maybe 75 pounds. He's smaller than my boy Bear. But you know, his the way that he hits, the way he goes his full force is what kind of just struck me.
With Ace, that's what got me. Ace was one of my dogs that were, I remember that because Ace, he was quick. If you weren't prepared, like our hands were out, you know what I'm saying? So once he goes to counter, if you weren't ready, he's taking your hand out.
Real, right? That power is different.
Yeah, it's way different.
Your dog has to be prepared to protect himself at the same time. You know what I'm saying? Like, if he bites somebody, he has to be prepared to bite. If they come with something else, they come with a knife, they come to hit him, he has to react on that and
it was,
yeah, counter bite, yeah.
It's actually the most logical sense of protection training. You know, it's a dog protecting themselves from a stab, you know, over the top of the head. Because really, if you bite at the dog, if you get the bite here, no matter if it grips down every time you struggle, if a knife comes down on the top of that dog's head, guess what? It's over. The dog is dead. No more biting, nothing, it's a wrap. Marlon is a good guy from DDK, so we're gonna be kind of going back and forth. He's actually coming down in April, and we're gonna, you know, work with him. He's gonna come down here and work with our dogs and kind of, we've actually taken a lot away from there. You know, we started doing tactical biting here, just cause, you know, it's real life. Another busy day here at Primal Canine. You know, I think I did 5 evaluations. We signed up like 3 dogs.
I had a private, which was their first private. Dogs' names were Riley and Buddy. One's more timid, insecure, but actually this past week, since our intro, there's a lot of improvement.
I had Jake, he's a pit bull. He was good, he was doing the heels, the sits, all good, right? But he had a tendency of jumping on people, doing all things, so we try to tailor that to our privates, to get the owner's needs, what they want. I did a little bit of stacking practice with Count, and then his free stacking, because I got to start getting him ready for the next upcoming show in about a few weeks. What stacking is, it's basically showing the full assets of your dog.
Teamed up with New York Live today, and they did some sports card photo shoots for our dogs. It's free, completely free, which was a cool thing. You know, me particularly, I was a little bit lazy to do it with my three, but I got forced to by my assistant and my sister slash trainer, Taylor.
And sit in circle! Circle your dog.
Oh, damn.
So remember, before we get into this little bit higher distraction, the biggest thing is you need to be more distracted than the distraction. So praise, communication, just keep it open. If they start being afraid of everything, you want to console them. Hey, it's okay, don't worry, you're fine. If they start becoming aggressive with something, or either they start bouncing around, then it's a question, you know, that's not acceptable. That's
group class is good. We want to expose our dogs to different places, and you know, we actually went through the underpass here where there's a train, there's cars. It's like the walkway is literally about 2.5 feet, so everyone has to walk through that one way, and it's just super crowded.
The cars were coming by, the dogs were getting a little bit like, what's going on, what's this?
It was fun. It was a little scary because, you know, we were standing in the street as cars were driving past us.
Yeah.
You know, and trying to like assist the people while, you know, if they were like, their dogs weren't doing it correctly, like, you know, helping them, but at the same time we're making sure we don't get ran over by a car.
Dogs did pretty well, you know, they did pretty well. They reacted a little bit to the car going by, which is natural, but they actually did really, really well. They still listened to the commands, you know, they didn't react too much, they didn't jump out of the way, they didn't get scared. They actually reacted to the commands really well.
It was a very, I won't say dangerous, but it was a dangerously controlled environment. That's kind of where you want to take your training. You know, if you train your dog in a certain place all day long, guess what? Your dog learns how to train in a certain place all day long. But when you start training your dog in different places, different atmospheres, different areas, then great, guarantee they're gonna learn to be in those, learn to train in those different areas. So you know that. In the dog training world, everyone thinks that their method is the greatest. They're the best at what they do. And you know what? If you work with dogs, you do things with dogs, that's awesome, great, more power to you. But you know, there is no one method.
Once you close your mind on one thing, that's all you got. If you got force training, you're force training every dog. And that one dog may not be the one to force train. It might mess them up in the long run.
The way it is, all dogs aren't the same. All people aren't the same. Everyone learns different. I could probably tell you, you know, how a dog, this one specific dog might learn, but I don't know how the owner learns. Meanwhile, I'm trying to train this owner how to train their dog. So I'll usually go through the exercise with the dog and say, oh, you know, your dog learns this way. Let's try this.
You know, you gotta correct the dog a certain way to make the dog listen. If that dog doesn't respond to that, what are you gonna do? Oh, that dog's a failure. I can't train it. No. You adjust to that dog.
It's all about, you know, keeping the open mind. I don't think I know everything about dog training. Granted, I have hundreds if not thousands of dogs that can prove that we know pretty well what we're doing here, and you know, we have all of our results are proven. But I don't think there's a plateau. We can always learn more, which is why we work with DDK, which is why we work with Terry Macias, which is why we're open to all dog trainers, you know, to come and learn, and you know, we can, you know, share thoughts and processes. I'm trying to have Primal Canine in every state, if not every city in the world. You know, that's our goal. And the only way I can do that is by improving in, you know, a kind of progression. If you think you're peaked, then you're wrong. It's about improvement at all times.